In the vibrant tapestry of Tudor England, one thread traces the intriguing and tumultuous life of this lady. Her journey weaves through the heart of the English court, entangling her with the most significant figures of her time. From her marriage to George Boleyn, the brother of the ill-fated Queen Anne Boleyn, to her complex relationship with the formidable King Henry VIII. She danced upon the perilous edge of power and betrayal, balancing within the sphere of royal intrigue where fortunes and fates could shift with the whisper of a scandal. Her tale is as intricate as the noble bloodlines that ran through the heart of Tudor society, fraught with shifting alliances, perilous secrets, and the dangerous game of royal favour. She experienced both the glittering summit of wealth and influence and the bitter dregs of disgrace. From the grand halls of Grimston Manor and the Palace of Beaulieu to the ominous confines of the Tower of London, her life was a swirling tempest of triumph and tragedy. She stands as an enigma, a woman whose life was forever woven with those of royals whose legacy is etched with the turbulent annals of England's history. Her story, in its stark human drama and intrigue, beckons us to delve deeper, to uncover the truth behind the woman and to explore the turbulent era she navigated. So join me now as we look back on the incredible life of Jane Boleyn, our Lady Rochford. Our story begins with a woman named Jane Parker, born into a world of power and prestige, yet destined for a life of tumultuous turns. She was the blood of the illustrious Parker lineage, the daughter of Henry Parker, the influential 10th Baron Morley, and Alice St. John, a woman of distinguished ancestry. The tendrils of Jane's family tree stretched out to mingle with that of royalty. Through her maternal line, she shared a distant kinship with King Henry VIII, a curious twist of fate that wove a destiny with the lives of the king's children, including her future niece by marriage, the formidable Elizabeth I. Born around 1505 amidst the gentle landscapes of Norfolk, Jane was a product of nobility that was both affluent and esteemed in English society. Her father, a connoisseur of culture and a champion of education, was a man of intellectual pursuits. Jane was introduced to the shimmering spectacle of the royal court in her tender years before blossoming into a 15-year-old woman. It was in the royal household of King Henry VIII's first queen, Catherine of Aragon, that she learned the ways of the court. Young Jane's feet treaded the historic soils of France during the state visit of 1520, known famously as the Field of the Cloth of Gold. However, Jane's physical allure remains an elusive mystery, with no portrait to tell her tale. However, hints of her beauty lurk in the annals of history, particularly in her biographer Julia Fox's speculation of a Holbein painting, possibly capturing her likeness. Her captivating charm is evident in her selection as a lead actress and dancer in the elite Chateau Ver masquerade at court in 1522. She was among the seven chosen ladies of the court, all handpicked for their beauty, a group that intriguingly included her soon-to-be sisters-in-law, Anne and Mary Boleyn. In the winter whispers of late 1524 or the early bloom of 1525, the life of Jane Parker swirled into an unexpected dance. She was betrothed to George Boleyn, brother to the vivacious Anne Boleyn. Anne was yet to be entwined in the king's passionate favour at this juncture, though her charm was already the talk of the court. The royal generosity of King Henry VIII ushered Jane into a new life, gifting the newlyweds Grimston Manor in Norfolk. When George was honoured with the title of Viscount Rochford in 1529, Jane too became a figure of note, earning the courtesy title of Viscountess Rochford. As the influence and affluence of the Boleyn family climbed the steps of power, Jane and George were bestowed the Grand Palace of Beaulieu in Essex as their primary residence. They embellished it with luxury, a testament to their elevated stature. A veritable palace that had once been the Boleyn's retreat was now the seat of their power. Yet beneath the gilded surface, whispers of discord echoed. The marital bond of Jane and George was painted with discontent by many, with some even speculating on George's sexual inclinations. Similarly enigmatic were Jane's relationships with her sisters-in-law, Anne and Mary Boleyn. The true nature of their sisterhood was veiled in ambiguity. It is often assumed that Jane harboured an excellent sentiment towards Anne, possibly fueled by envy. But despite these possible resentments, Jane found herself entangled in courtly schemes with Anne, leading to the banishment of a young mistress of the king in 1534. However, the king's wrath found her, leading to Lady Rochford's temporary exile from the court. So the complexities of Lady Rochford's life began to unravel, a dance of power and passion set against the backdrop of a turbulent Tudor court. In the 11th year of her stormy matrimony, Lady Rochford's life abruptly turned. In the bloom of May 1536, her husband George Boleyn found himself trapped in the formidable grip of the law. He was arrested and confined within the chilling stone walls of the Tower of London, charged with the most scandalous crime, incestuous relations with his sister, Queen Anne. Elizabeth Somerset, the Countess of Worcester, reportedly fueled the accusation, yet the truth of these allegations remained shrouded in mystery. The broader consensus among contemporaries leaned towards their falsehood, yet this was the pretext Boleyn's adversaries needed to orchestrate George's downfall. Jane's name echoed once within the trial's proceedings, linked to an inquiry if the Queen had revealed any intimate details about King Henry VIII's virility. Notably, any hatred between Jane and George became part of the narrative much later, after both their deaths. George Wyatt, in his biography of Queen Anne, painted Jane as a vengeful spouse, dubbing her the accuser who sought her own husband's life. However, this image was undoubtedly tinted by later events, specifically the Catherine Howard episode and Wyatt's endeavour to absolve Queen Anne. The perception that Jane testified against her husband and sister-in-law out of resentment rather than a genuine belief in their guilt has shaped her portrayal in historical narratives. A century later, one historian maintained that Jane's alleged testimony was spurred by a deep-seated envy of Queen Anne's social prowess and George's fondness for his sister over his wife. There is no mention of a significant rift between the couple, and existing references suggest a relationship of at least good harmony. Even in the face of adversity, Jane salvaged her reputation in court. She was even among the chief mourners at the death of Jane Seymour, yet the echoes of her past caught up to her in 1542, leading to her execution. This event gave rise to a view of Jane deserving her fate, being painted as an architect of Anne Boleyn's fall and her husband's fall. However, unsupported by historical evidence, this perception took root posthumously and was perpetuated by later historians. On the 17th of May 1536, an unsettling chill fell upon Tower Hill. On this day, George Boleyn was led to the executioner's block. His final utterances echoed around the silent crowd, but they were not of pleading or fear. Instead, George seized the occasion to voice his newfound Protestant faith. He was not alone though in this ghastly spectacle. Alongside him, four others met the same grisly fate, each man accused of being Anne's lover. And only one, a humble musician, Mark Smeaton, had confessed, a confession reportedly extracted through savage torture. 2 days later, Anne herself was led to the scaffold within the high stone walls of the Tower of London. Her execution was the work of a French swordsman, and her bravery and grace in those final moments evoked much admiration. Public sentiment swelled for Anne in the aftermath, painting her as a tragically persecuted heroine, a figure of grace, elegance, and youthful promise. The shadow cast by these events on Jane remains shrouded in ambiguity. It is unknown if she bore witness to the grim demise of her husband or sister-in-law. Still, the wave of sympathy that followed Anne's death invariably recast those implicated in her downfall as arch-villains, Jane included. In the wake of Boleyn's fall, Jane navigated a dangerous path. Battered by social and financial storms, the Boleyns had painstakingly accumulated lands and titles, including the earldoms of Wiltshire and Ormond, over Anne's reign and four preceding generations. These being strictly benevolent were lost with George's death. Jane continued to bear the courtesy title of Viscountess Rochford, yet without a son to inherit what remained of the Boleyn fortune, she found herself at the mercy of a stark financial reality. The persistent rumour that Jane and George had a son, the flamboyant Dean of Lichfield, George Boleyn, had been largely debunked by modern historians. So once again, our protagonist finds herself in the eye of a storm, a woman of noble birth, grappling with a cruel and unpredictable reality. And the journey ahead promises to be as violent as the chapters preceding it. Following the chilling echoes of her husband's execution, Lady Rochford found herself in a void, distanced from the glimmering court that had once been the epicentre of her life. She remained in the wings for months, a spectral figure, working behind the scenes, negotiating with intimidating men like her father-in-law, Sir Thomas Boleyn, and Thomas Cromwell. But her efforts bore fruit as an annual pension of £100, a pittance compared to her prior income, but sufficient to maintain her noble status. It was the key to her eventual return to court, a goal she laboured relentlessly towards. When precisely she reclaimed her place at court remains a mystery. However, it is known that she served as a lady-in-waiting to Queen Jane Seymour, implying that she found her way back within a year of her husband's demise. As a vice-countess, she arrived back in the court's fold, trailed by a retinue of her servants permitted to reside in the king's palaces, and greeted as Lady Rochford. Following Queen Jane Seymour's untimely death, King Henry took Anne of Cleves as his wife, an arrangement orchestrated by Cromwell. Yet the match proved unsatisfactory for the king, and wishing to rid himself of Anne, he sought an annulment. In a move that echoed past machinations, Lady Rochford once again found herself as a vital pawn, attesting that the queen confided in her of the non-consummation of the marriage. The testimony paved the way for Henry's annulment and subsequent marriage to Catherine Howard, a distant relation to the Boleyns. Remaining dedicated at her post as a lady-in-waiting, Lady Rochford now served Queen Catherine. However, the Queen's past indiscretions bubbled to the surface in the autumn of 1541, prompting a scrutinising probe into her private affairs. As Queen Catherine was confined first to her quarters and then under house arrest at Sion Abbey, her confidants were subjected to questioning and their quarters ransacked. Lady Rochford, embroiled in the accusations of facilitating secret rendezvous between the Queen and Thomas Culpepper, was also apprehended for questioning. As our story nears its turbulent end, we find Lady Rochford ensnared in the cold, grim grasp of the Tower, under the oppressive weight of accusation and interrogation. She was not tortured, but bore the physical trauma of her circumstances. She spiralled into the abyss of her mind, her once vibrant spirit shattered into pieces by the onslaught of nervous collapse. By the dawn of 1542, her mental deterioration was such that she was proclaimed insane. Her fits of frenzy, as they were termed, would have typically exempted her from standing trial for her alleged role in the Queen's supposed adultery. However, the King manipulated the legal system, adamant in his desire to see her punished. A new law, akin to a dark, twisted key, was introduced, granting the power to execute even the insane if they were accused of high treason. Condemned by this act of attainder, Jane's fate was sealed. Her execution scheduled for the 13th of February, 1542, a grim date she shared with Queen Catherine. The Queen was the first to face the harsh blade of execution, her physical strength as frayed as her life's thread. In contrast, Jane emerged calm and composed as she was led to the bloodied scaffold where the Queen had just knelt. In the face of death, she displayed an unexpected tranquility that softly echoed in the annals of history, earning her a subtle ripple of posthumous respect. Otwell Johnson, a merchant and eyewitness to the event, reflected, "Their souls be with God, for they made the most godly and Christian end." Her body found its final resting place in the hallowed grounds of St. Peter ad Vincula within the Tower of London. There, she was laid to rest beside Queen Catherine, her mortal remains to mingle with those of Anne Boleyn and her husband, George Boleyn, their lives now echoing through time in a chorus of vociferous destinies.